All right, we are live. Hey there,
Hello.
how are you?
Yeah, very good. How are you?
I'm doing all right.
Exciting technology.
All right, hey there, everyone. Welcome to another Believe in Magic Q&A. My name's Alex Borton, and I'll be your host today. Our special guest today is this is all on restaurant magic. This is for you, Wayne. This is Wayne Goodman. Hello, Wayne.
Hello.
Woo!
Hello, and hello from England.
Absolutely. Hello from America. All of you guys from the UK are always so awesome when you're on. So it's I don't know what it is about the English being nice and
I'm
polite.
having tea. I have tea here. I'm all right. I'm all right. I've got tea here. If you see this, tea. I was gonna have a Jack Daniels and Coke. I thought that might be a bit more rock and roll, but I went for the tea. You
I
got
would have
a
gone with Coke.
Coke.
Pepsi, sponsor us. No,
Pour a little bit into the, yes. Well, actually, I'm going to show off now because this is a limited edition Magic Magazine mug. There's only about a
Ooh.
million of them in the world. Can't get them
That's
anymore.
amazing.
I know. That's when you get to my level, you see what I get? That's what I get, mugs. Oh,
I'll tell you
hot
what,
stuff.
I liked the other mug you had earlier because it was very English. At that point, that was like crested and shielded and whole nine yards. It was very, very like, you know
It's
what
a
I'm saying?
Harry Potter. It's a Harry Potter Gryffindor mug, but it does
Oh,
look
that
like a.
explains it.
It's like an
That
English
explains
tankard, isn't it? It's like, oh, hello. That's what we all drink. We don't have those little cups over here. We have massive vats of tea. That's all we do. That's all. We don't even have water. That comes out of the tap.
Just Earl of Grey out of the
Oh,
tap coming.
great! Yeah, just out of the tap, out the hot water tap. Yeah. So I shower in that. I'll tell you, I'm like that. Yeah, lovely.
Oh man, what is it? God, Starship Enterprise. Who is that?
Oh,
Car.
Picard. Jean-Luc Picard, Patrick Stewart.
Patrick Stewart, him and his Earl of Grey. That's just one of those things, man. all right. So let's jump into get down into the a little bit more into the point of this. For the people who don't know you, Wayne, can you give a little bit about yourself and kind of what you do?
Yeah, well, I'm a full-time pro. So magic, I make my full living from magic. I've got to think now. I started off as a children's entertainer. I then started doing close up in the very early part of the 90s. Started working on some ships around the UK and then around Scandinavia. And then in 2000, I moved to Spain. I'd done a couple of seasons in Spain before that over the winter. And I worked, and then me and another guy set up a bar called the House of Illusion in Salou, Spain, which is still open, still running. Then in 2006, my dad passed away, so I came back to the UK. And I've always done, like I said, I've always done the close up, always been very into that. So coming back to the UK and not having a client base here, and the only clients who knew me as a kids magician, I wanted to spread out. So I started working in restaurants. I'd done table hopping back in the 90s at a cabaret club in town here. And so I approached restaurants, I started working in the restaurants, and I very quickly built up a reputation for being the go-to guy about restaurant magic. And other people would ask me questions. I used to get asked a lot of questions about how to get into restaurants, how do I do it, how do I work it. And then in 2010, I think it was, me and a guy called Stephen Leithwaite. He's my best mate, my closest mate. I love him like a brother. We're very, very close. And we did it. He used to come and doss at my house and stay over at my house quite a lot, even though he lives hundreds of miles away. And so we started going to gigs together, and we thought, you know what we're going to do? We're going to record a podcast in the car, two fat blokes in a car, just talking about magic. And we only did three episodes, but they were really well received. Everyone loved them. And we were just chatting and discussing magic. And we got talking about restaurant magic. And we got a flurry of questions from people just off that one podcast. Probably getting on to like 500, 600, 700 questions being sent to me from different people about restaurant magic. So one winter, not the one just gone, but the one before, I sat down and spent 6 months and I wrote this, and that's the book. it seems to have gone down very, very well. People like it. There's no fluff in the book. There's no, and this isn't going to be a sales pitch, but it's available. There's no fluff inside the book. There's no filler. It goes straight to the subject matter. A lot of people have said they like it because it's very conversational. So it's like when you're reading it, it's like I'm talking to you. And that was it, really. It just really, really went from there. At the moment, I work in 9 restaurants. So I have 9 residencies at the moment. Some of those are weekly. I do 1 restaurant, 2 shows on a Sunday. Some restaurants are bi-monthly, and I'll do 1 month on, 1 show in 1 month, and then have a month off, and then do 1 show again. I've got a couple of those ones, and a couple of ones I'm at every week, every 2 weeks, every month, every 2 months. That's a large chunk of my income comes from being in the restaurant scene. So I think I am qualified a little bit to talk about it. And I know what I'm doing. I think, it works so far. I make a living. What can I say?
Hey, you know what? If you can support yourself doing magic, you have some authority on doing something right, and that's at least that's my opinion. You know, if you can claim pro because of just magic, then that's it. You know, we have tons.
This is the only job I've ever had.
What's up?
It's the only job I've ever had. I've never had another job. I worked in a school briefly for a couple of years when I was 16. But even then, that was just so that the kids would book me for their birthday parties. it was the only job I've ever done, really. So it's scary. Anybody out there who's thinking about getting into doing magic, I've got a couple of students who I mentor. And my first thing is, if you want to do close-up for a living, get a residency. Because there's no better way to practice. Like on my Facebook, anybody who's friends with me on Facebook will see continually I'm putting up comments like, I'm working at this restaurant, come down, I'm doing 3 new tricks today. And I'm continually trying out new material. And I invent tricks as well. I'm a creator as well. So if I want to work a new trick in, I know I've got 4 shows in a week or 5 shows in a week at restaurants that are friendly crowds of people that I know that I can go and work those material. And I'm working some nights. I'm working on a Tuesday or a Wednesday, which notoriously isn't a busy night. It's restaurant magic is great for that. One of my restaurants does Monday night magic, and they do Monday nights is magic night, and I go in, I do magic once a month on a Monday. Yeah, it's great.
So I've been. I was gonna say that's the big difference because what I do is mostly busking. I do some bar hopping. I don't have any residency. I had one. For a little while, that I'd go out and see weekly, Sundays, Sunday nights. But besides that, most of the time I busk, and I will notice that as a performer doing both, I can definitely see what you're talking about. Sitting down at a restaurant where you have regulars, people are coming by, they know that you're going to be there. They're either coming to see you or they're, coming knowing that it's going to be you there and, they're familiar with you. Whereas when you're sitting out busking is just one of those things that, the nice part is you get a new group every 5 minutes.
Yep.
But or less. But, at the same time, you, as much as you can work stuff in, you could fail a bunch of times and it just... it's discouraging. Whereas, at least if you mess something up, you got the your friends around you, kind of to go, hey, it's okay.
Yeah, I've had people very rude to me in the restaurant. You got to the table. It's not personal. That's the big thing. It's not personal. But you go up and you go, hi, do you want to see some magic? And then they go, rah, and you walk away, and it can be downheartening. And you walk away and you go, well, that was just rude. And then you get really sad and you think about it. But, if you're surrounded by people who are, I got on very well with the waiting staff in all my restaurants. So, they'll come to me and go, oh, he's just really rude, that bloke. And it's sort of like, it's not just me they're being at. It's kind of like, it's nice to have a supportive group around you.
Right. It's like a support group. You have the staff, you have regulars, you have all that. So if things go wrong, you at least, you have a good
vibe. If I do a couple of tables, if I get neglected, if I get rejected from a couple of tables, I go and go, do you want to see some magic? And they go, no. Then I'll go find a regular and I'll show them something new and I'll get some clapping and cheering in the bar and then I'll go back into the restaurant again. You know, it's sort of like a reset button. I've just defeated the boss at level one. Now I'm going at level two. You know, go over, do a bit over here, back over here again. There we go. I also find, this is quite important, if you're getting into restaurant magic or any kind of magic in that kind of environment, if you go to the table and they say no, that's not the end of their experience of you in the restaurant. Because I've been turned away from many tables, many, many tables, and then called back to the same table because they haven't realized what I was doing. They thought they had to pay for me, even though I tell them it's free. They have to, or they think that I'm a con man or a charlatan or something. But I'll do a table, and then they'll go, oh, actually, can we see something? And I would say probably 75 to 90% of the time, the people who turn me away will call me back over at a later time when they actually realize what's going on. So if you are getting into magic in restaurants, and you do get, you know, if you're a bit worried about that, you'll be surprised at how often you get called back over and actually involved. And I've got bookings from that. I've had people turn me away, call me back, and then booked me for an event, which is, you know, it's like the complete turnaround of it.
Right. Well, I think that's a good important point to make, is that, you know, if you're getting into magic and you're getting into it to perform for other people, not just to be a hobbyist and, you know, perform for yourself and your core group of friends, you know, you're going to mess up. And you're, you know, even your best trick, you're going to mess up at some point in front of somebody. And it's going to have other things. Sometimes some people just don't like magic and you just can't get discouraged. There's, what, 9.6 billion people in the world? Like, and a decent amount of them like magic. Find somebody else. You know, somebody will appreciate it. Don't get discouraged.
Some people, I've had religious people who don't like it because they think it's, you know, to their race. I have people who are a little bit scared of it because they think that I'm going to pickpocket them or steal their watch or damage something. I've got some people who just don't like magic. You know, it's just not their thing. But for every one person who doesn't, there's 100 people who do. So, yeah, just move on and just, you know, if you argue with them, you're never going to win them over. So just leave them alone. Just, you know, right, fine, no problem, thank you very much. That's actually the biggest question I get asked, actually. How do you deal with rejection? I don't know if that's on the list of questions.
Let me see here. I don't see that on the list of questions, but that's a great place to start, dealing with rejection. That's something I'm really good at.
I was going to add with women as well, but I'm not going to say that. I am. I'm really good. Yeah, you know, women. Yeah. No, anyway, dealing with rejection is a great thing. It's one of the big questions I get asked is, you know, what do you do when you go over and you do your speech and they just go no, you know, and it's soul destroying, and it's I always think magic is one of the hardest of the performing arts, in as much as if you're up on stage, I worked in Spain and on the ships with singers and bands and that. And if you're a dancer and no one's watching you or taking, you know, interest in what you're doing, well, you can still dance, yeah? If you're a dance group, you can just get on and dance and just do it. If you're a singer and everybody's talking, you can still sing, you know? It's soul-destroying and it's horrible, but you can just sing your songs and just block out the people and just do it for yourself. But if you're a magician, especially like myself, I'm a comedy magician, if they're not listening or taking part, that's a long time to be there. So when it comes to the tables, you know, it has the same sort of effect as if I got to five tables in a row and they all reject me, well, I start thinking maybe it's me, you know, and it's not. Everyone has their own unique reason. So you have to, first of all, you have to be dispassionate about it. You have to take all emotion out of it and be 100% professional. You have to go to yourself, right, it's not me. Yeah, these people are just not the magic crowd.
And you've got it as a job.
Yeah, you just got to not take it personally. Don't make it emotional. Don't make it about you.
And it's hard because, and maybe I'm wrong here, but it's just the metaphor that popped into my head was close-up magicians tend to be the door-to-door salesmen of the entertainment world. And
That's brilliant. Well, you are. You're going up to them. You're going to the table. One thing I really, really hate is the magicians who go up to a table and before they even ask if they can do some magic, they're performing. oh, did you drop this knife? No, they didn't. Because who takes a knife to a restaurant? Right? Oh, or they open their wallet and fire bursts out of it. What? This is like, it's magic against their consent. You know, it is. And I find that really disrespectful. You know, if they want to see magic, then I will do magic for them. If they don't want to see magic, I'm not going to push myself, because then you become you're hard selling, and you're just making them more annoyed. Imagine somebody comes to you if you're having dinner with your family, and somebody comes up and says, "Hello, I am Jack. Can I sing for you?" And then to start singing, you're going to be like, "No, I didn't want that. Why are you just, you know?" It's the same thing. You've got to respect boundaries. And yeah, plus magic has a stigma. You know, people think that you're going to be some cheesy, and I am. I have loads of cheesy one-liners. I love them. But you know.
You know, bad guys, the way Penn says it, bad guys doing really cruddy tricks in front of Mylar, torturing women to bad, like, Motown music. That's what people, rabbits out of hats, SpongeBalls. Yeah. Not that there's anything wrong with SpongeBalls, but, like...
No, I do SpongeBalls. I love SpongeBalls.
It seems like everybody does the same routine of one ball here, one ball here. Okay, now you put one ball in your hand, and this one goes away. Now you have two in your hand. You know,
That's my other hate, those effects. Do you know what? I remember watching a guy once, and this actually genuinely happened. I was in a restaurant with my best mate, another friend of mine called Oliver, and this guy comes over to the table next to us, and it was just a bar in London. He didn't know who we were. I don't know who he is, but he comes over, and he says to the woman, "Can I do some magic?" And the woman goes, "Yes, please." So, well, we're magicians. We're interested. We're watching as well. And he goes, "Okay, I've got one ball here and one ball here. Now, this one goes in this hand. This one goes down here. This one on the table goes in the hand over here. And this one goes in my pocket. So how many have I got in my hand?" And the woman went, "I just wanted a coffee. That's all I wanted, just a cup of coffee." You know, so I don't care. It's too complicated. Move on, you know. I thought you were going to have a card or something. And it was just the way she just went, "I only came in for a cup of coffee." And it was just like completely blew him, and it was like, "Arr." It's that hurts magic more than anything else. That kind of stuff, yeah, you want to steer clear of all that. So with rejection, when you go up to the table, be polite, be courteous, respect that you're coming into their personal space, respect that you don't know their circumstances. For instance, I went up to the table once and said, "Can I do some magic for you?" And they went, "We're really not interested." And I said, "No problem, that's no problem." And I walked away. And then the lady from the table came over to me a few minutes later and said, "Oh, I hope you don't think we're being rude." And I went, "Of course not. No, of course not." I said, "You're chatting and stuff, that's fine. If you change your mind," she went, "Well, my mum's just died, and we've all come to talk about the funeral." Now, I didn't know that, right? So, but you just have to respect that you don't know the situation you're walking into. They could be there for that. The brothers and sisters have all come together, talk about the funeral. They didn't want some bloke doing card tricks for them, you know. But, and they were courteous, they said no thank you and stuff, you know. But you don't know who you're going to talk to. And it could be, you could go up to the guy, he could be just about to propose to his girlfriend. And so he goes, "No, I don't want to see any magic. Come back later," or "go away," you know. And you don't know the situation that's happening. So when they do turn you away, if you do get rejected, you don't know the situation behind it. It could be they don't like you, or they don't know the magic, or it could be that there's something else going on. So just don't take it personally and just move on. You know,
well, the story you mentioned with the table and family and funeral, I've heard that story for almost verbatim from other people. Going, you know, and luckily, you know, a lot of them will handle it the same way is another Q&A I think I did, we were talking about restaurant magic, and he had said almost the exact same thing, and that's difficult. I mean, you don't know. At any given time, you're in your own world, and they're in their own world. So you're walking, you're not joining worlds, you're walking into their world at that point.
They're not walking in. You're walking in uninvited.
Right.
If they haven't seen you working the tables and called you over, then you are basically cold calling at that table. And that's where a lot of magicians fail, because they think that the whole reason those people are there are to see them, and they're not. They're there to have a meal, maybe a reunion, or whatever reason. And again, 70-90% of people will accept you at the table, no problem. But you've got to respect that some people are not interested and they won't want to watch what you for whatever reason that you're doing it. You know, it's and that once you realise that, you know, I always think of it like this: if I get rejected from a table, I think to myself, well, if I had done magic at that table, I would have been there for 5, 6 minutes, 10 minutes most, you know, and then I would have to find another table. So all I'm doing now is just knocking out that 10 minutes and just going to go and find another table. You know, I'm back to square one. And as a close-up table hopper, that's all it is. You do the trick, you're back to the start. You do the tricks, you're back to the start. You go to the table, you're back to the start. You go to the table, you're back to the start. So, you know, if they turn you away, okay, I'll go somewhere else. I'll go into another section of the restaurant and I'll try my luck over there and just move on.
Well, and that's something because I started just going out to people personally, and just trying stuff, not like the whole David Blaine or the rest of these magic specials where they take a camera guy out and I find a guy on the street and be like, hey, you want to see some magic? Like, I set up shop and was like, hey, like, if anybody wants to stop and watch, that would be cool, and if not, you know, that's your choice. And then just hawk at people and jag-jaw at people and whatnot. But, again, that the whole busking thing is people move on, and then you just reset and you do your set again. You have your setup. Actually, and that gets into another question that we'll get into in just a second. But it's not the end of the world if anybody says no. Lots of people could say no. It really depends on the night and what's going on and who's around.
The trouble comes when you get rejected a certain number of times from the tables. You start to think, all right, what's going on? Why does nobody want to see me tonight? And that would happen to me. If I did 10 tables and they all said no in a row, I would start to feel a bit, okay, you know, it's sort of like, you know, but yeah, you just got to, it's, they're not there to see you. You're an extra, you're a novelty, you're a speciality, you know, but you're not going to be, the chef doesn't get, this is my way of always thinking about it. The chef doesn't get angry if nobody orders the cheesecake. Yeah. So if 100 people come into the restaurant and they all order a different dessert, but nobody orders a cheesecake, he's not there thinking, why is no one ordering the cheesecake? You know, he's busy doing everything else he's got to do and get on with it. You know, and it's some nights you're the cheesecake and everybody will have you, and some nights you're the cheesecake and nobody wants to see you. And that's just the way it goes.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's a little easier to take for a restaurant because nobody wants the cheesecake. These guys don't want the cheesecake. Maybe these guys will. But that's the hard part about stages. If you have, and we have some questions about going and turning it into dinner shows and things like that. But that is the hard problem with stages. Now you have everybody's attention. So you either have everybody or nobody's attention. Yeah. And it can turn just like that. I don't want to get too far from questions, though. We should probably get into a few of the actual questions that were asked. No, absolutely. I could sit here and talk about this stuff forever. We've gotten a lot of mentalists on recently, and I love talking to them, and I'm getting more into mentalism, but that's not what I've done. So it's nice to talk to somebody with experience in what I'm doing right now. So I could sit here and chat for hours.
You want to try and get Michael Murray on the show. He's a guy over here in the UK. He's amazing, absolutely amazing mentalism.
He's on my friends list. He's been on the list of people we're going to try to invite. I think we got all sorts of people we're trying to get on. But that's I think we have Banachek coming up. We have Daniel Madison. We have a bunch of good guys coming through. But yeah, no, absolutely. Michael Murray's
Am I warming up? Am I warming up the crowd for Banachek, am I?
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. You're warming up for Banachek, warming them up for Banachek on the 27th. So, for those of you watching, Banachek,
I've got a fork in somewhere. I can do a fork bend if you want. Yeah, watch it closely. So what questions have we got there? Let's hit some of these questions. What have we got here?
Let's just start from... really from the beginning. And when I say beginning, we're talking about restaurant magic. The first question being, how do you approach an owner to get permission to perform at that restaurant, or approach them about being a performer for them?
Okay, so how do you approach the restaurant, the venue? How do you get into the venue in the first place?
Yeah.
This is something again, you're going to get rejected a lot. So, you know, that's part and parcel of it. When I first came back from Spain, I sent a lot of letters out and emails out and got no response from that at all. Because people who work in restaurants, the managers, etc., they get hundreds of emails and letters and things asking them questions that they've got no time to deal with. So if it gets looked at, most of them just go straight in the bin. And I realized that very quickly. So what I started to do was, I started to notice that when I was out with my friends, this is going to sound really cheeky now, if I go into my town tonight, if I was to head into town later on, and I have done this, I don't take any money with me most of the time. Because I know within 10, 15 minutes of being in a bar, I'll be doing some tricks for people, and then I'll get free drinks. You know, it started off as a bit of a jokey thing, and sometimes if I'm having a quiet month and I don't want to spend any money, I'll just go down and do a few tricks in town and have a few free drinks. But I had noticed that when I'm doing the magic for people, it obviously generates a lot of interest, and the staff would take notice. So I very quickly realized that by making myself known to them, it was a step in the door, really. So when I want to approach a restaurant now, what I'll tend to do is I'll go into the restaurant. Most restaurants have a bar area. So sometimes I'll just go in and order a cup of tea or a Coke, and I'll sit in the bar and I'll talk to the bar staff. You know, when does it get busy in here? Stuff like that. And then if the bar staff wants to see a couple of tricks, I'll do a couple of tricks for them. If not, no problems. If they're really busy doing other stuff, I won't bother with that. But I'll make sure I take one of the business cards for the restaurant. And then I'll just drop an email to the restaurant saying, I was in the restaurant the other day. I saw it's quite busy. Seems like a fun place. How would you like to add an extra sparkle? And I won't ask for a meeting, but I'll put at the end of the email, I will be coming in for a cup of tea, or I will be passing by again in a few days. I will see if I can pop in and just say hello. Now, sometimes this elicits a response, and I get a message saying, oh, that'd be great, come in, you know, I work on this day. Sometimes I get nothing back, but it doesn't matter. I'll then go into the venue, and I'll see the bar staff, and I'll remind them who I am if they don't recognize me, and then I'll say I'm the magician, and then I'll ask to speak to the manager, and the manager will come over, and so I've preempted that I'm coming in. Almost every single time I've done this, they've said, oh, yeah, I read your email, which is a good sign. So then I'll do a couple of quick tricks to the manager. I won't do a show for him. When you go in, these people haven't got time for this. They want to talk business, because the only way they can stop doing what they're supposed to be doing is if they're doing business, if it's work. So I talk to them about their covers. I learn the lingo. A cover is the table, how many people at the table. So how many covers have you got tonight? Oh, we've got 15 covers. That means they've got 15 tables booked. Yeah, so it's you learn the lingo, you learn the language. And so I was going to say, hey, how many covers do you get on a Thursday or Friday night? Which are your busy nights? Do you have any entertainment in here? How would you like to have something that generates, and this is the important one, how would you like to have something that generates interest in the bar that will bring people into the bar and also repeat custom from the customers who are already coming in? How would you like to have something that can cover any problems in the bar? If there's a delay in the kitchen for 5-10 minutes, send me over to the rest to that table and I will keep them occupied. If you've got a difficult customer, someone who's being a bit of an idiot, I'll go over and I'll do something for them and get them on side. And so I'm showing him things which are more important than the tricks. I'm showing him that what I can do for him is make his life a little bit easier in respect to people waiting for tables, people waiting for food. I can bring something to the bar that nobody else is doing, and it's going to help to generate repeat custom and new custom. It's something he can advertise that's proactive and isn't 2-for-1 on burgers. You know, it's going to be something that people are going to go, oh, they've got entertainment in there tonight. And it does work. I don't know how it is in America, but in England, almost all the pubs in my area advertise that they have a disco or a band on a Friday and a Saturday night, because they know it's going to bring people in, because it's something entertainment-wise. So why not for restaurants as well? and it works.
That's a very similar experience here. The one bar that I did hold residency at was kind of just one of those things. Very similar. I didn't have much money that weekend, and I was not sure what I was going to do, and my wife was working, and I just walked over to the local bar and took some deck of cards and a few other little knick-knacky things and sat down and ordered a soda and did some tricks for some people until somebody bought me a drink. The staff actually told the owner and wanted me to talk to them, and I also do air conditioning, so I got a twofer on them because I started doing their air conditioning and coming on Sundays and doing their magic and whatnot. They had open mic nights, but because they had an indoor section and an outdoor section, I could go while they're doing open mic and stuff. I could very easily go out to their outdoor patio, and there was always a good group of people. And if you can show them, I was performing just of my own. I was just coming in to do it for me, you know, get practice and things like that. But like people started coming just to hang. They knew I'd be there on Sundays, and they'd come to hang out. And once she saw that, she was like, oh, yeah, maybe I should, you know, have you come in, and this could be a thing and whatnot. So, like, something, and you didn't mention it because these are sales terms, and sales sounds slimy, but building value. You have to build value in yourself, and perceived value is the most important thing to anybody.
And it's not just about monetary value either. It's not just monetary value, but value of, you know, to help. If, for instance, one of my restaurants has been a Sunday lunch because they know they have a lot of families in at that time, and if there's something going on like a magician, it keeps everyone involved and entertained. And, of course, everybody wants their Sunday lunch between 1 and 3, so it's very, very busy, and the kitchen staff are very, very busy. And so the smallest mistake can have a knock-on effect. So by having me there, they know they can go, Wayne, their food's going to be 5 more minutes. Can you go and do some magic for them? And I'll go over and keep them entertained. And they'll never realize that there was a 5-minute delay. They'll never know that they were kept waiting. So it's not just the monetary value. It's also it's perceived value of the whole package. It's very important. I'd also say on this point as well, don't underestimate as well the power of the regular. And what I mean by that is, almost every restaurant that I work in, like I say, has a bar area. And in that bar area, there's always the same people who come in every day after work. But these people aren't just, well, they are alcoholics probably, but they're not just alcoholics. These people have the ear of the manager. They have the ear of the manager. So if you find out who the regular is at the bar and go over and you impress them, then when the manager comes out later on, that regular will say to the manager, wow, did you see the magician? He was amazing. And they go, oh, did you watch him? And they go, oh, my God, he did this and he did that. He was absolutely amazing. And that, in your credit, is worth more than anything else, I think. I think hearing from the regular that they liked you. I've got one regular at one restaurant who I don't like very much. I think she's very, very rude. She's quite up herself. But you know what? I make her Sunday every Sunday because I go over and I show her something every Sunday because she loves me and she thinks what I do is brilliant. Now, I don't like her very much, but I do it because I know when the manager comes out and they'll go, oh, what do you think this week? And she'll go, oh, he's just amazing. I can't believe what he did. He bent my coin or he did this or he did that. And it's having those people, it's the old saying, have your friends close and your enemies closer. By keeping her on side, I know that I'm getting feedback direct to the manager who then, you know, that probably means more to her than all the applause and all the clapping. When she hears that she's happy, she's the regular, she knows how the restaurant runs.
Well, it sounds disingenuous, but honestly, when you're talking about it from a business perspective, you don't always like the people you're working with, and she, for, you know, better or worse, you don't always like the customer, but you're going to do what you can for the customer and make the customer happy, because the customer, a happy customer means money in your wallet. And yep, that's really important to remember, is that
we have a saying in the UK, happy wife, happy life. And it applies to the customer as well, you know. It doesn't rhyme, but happy customer, happy life, you know, happy wife.
Right.
Happy.
Well, I was going to say, it's kind of like, you know, I mean, marriage of convenience still happen. You're
I ain't marrying that woman. I am not marrying that woman. I'm not saying
marriage, but within the idea of relationships, you know, relationships of convenience in general, like, are one of those things that still exist. So it's not that bad to play on it if you're putting in effort. And you're trying to do it right, you know. I saw another one here, and this is kind of what I was wondering about. Negotiating prices with the owner. I'll be perfectly honest, when I was doing my thing, because I was doing other stuff, I didn't really get paid much. I mostly got a free tab and then was able to go and get tips. And that didn't bother me too much because I did decently with tips. And, you know, by the end of the night, I had 4 or 5 Long Islands in me, and, you know, that's like $50.
Yeah.
That's like $50 right there. So, like, you know, that's a good night for me if I made $50 on top of that.
Do you know what? Fees are one of the things that it seems they crop up in Magic all the time, and as the conversation progresses, the egos take over and they go up and up and up, and then you get the guy going, well, I don't get out of bed for less than 10 grand, and you're like, well, that's not true. When it comes to fees, it is very, how can I put this? When I wrote the book, I played with not putting a chapter on fees in, because where I live is out in the country, and it's not a big place, but if I was to live 100 miles away in London, then I know I could get a lot more. So first of all, residency work, working in restaurants, is probably one of the lowest forms of magic there is. However, I still earn a good wage off the places that I work. Now, in the book, and Kyle, the guy who reviews for Murphy's, slated me for this, but whatever. I say I don't accept tips. Yeah. Now, I understand, and maybe I should have put it better in the book, because when I wrote it, I didn't really think about where the book was going, to be honest, with regards to this. But in America, is a very tip-heavy country. So. I know there are guys in the UK and other places as well who will work just for tips. I understand that. I don't. I have a fee, and if anyone offers me a tip, I generally don't accept it. What I say to the customer, I will say, that's very kind, thank you very much. We split the tips, so just leave it for the waitress. Now, most of the restaurants I work in, they don't split the tips, but the waitress gets the tip. They normally get a bigger tip, so they're happy that I'm going into the restaurant, because when I'm there, they get bigger tips, and the customer thinks that I'm getting the money, but I'm already earning a good wage, and I would rather keep the waitresses on side because they enable me to work better. So with the fee, regards to the fee, I mean, this won't be accurate because I haven't got a monetary converter in front of me, but the cheapest restaurant that I work in pays me about £120, so for a 2-hour period. So that's £120.
That's like
$180, $200. That sort of area.
That's like you said 120.
Yeah.
That's going to be like 240, 250.
Really, as much as that.
Yeah, the conversion right now, you guys are just over twice.
Wow.
Just over twice.
I'm coming to America.
Yeah, no, I went to Ireland, and because when I was in Northern Ireland, they did the conversion. It may be a little less than that right now, but when I went, I probably spent $1,500, but it was only like £700.
Yeah. Well, I guess.
So, yeah.
That's my sort of like my cheapest. I've got one that pays me 200. I've got one that pays me. But I did have one before, and they only paid me 50. So that's like $100. But in the book, I go into quite a lot of detail about it, because in fact, bear with me just 1 second. Let me open it. Let me explain it from the book, because I've got some figures in here. And I talk about, if I'm working a big restaurant, like Frankie and Benny's. Do you have Frankie and Benny's over in America?
No.
Okay. It's sort of like a Wendy's, I suppose. I don't know.
Are you talking like a family restaurant, or are you talking more
like Nando's, Chiquitos, TGI, that kind of thing?
Okay. So yeah.
A big chain family restaurant. Yeah. Okay. Now we have one over here called Frankie and Benny's, and my local Frankie and Benny's is one of the busiest in the country. They have a big turnover. They're only a small town, but they have a big turnover. And they're very, very busy. They're busy from 9 o'clock in the morning for breakfasts, straight away through to 11 o'clock at night. They're busy all the time. Now, in here, it's actually, I generally get paid between 100 and 250 for my residencies. Now, if I'm working in a large chain restaurant, let's say I've got a large chain restaurant with 40 tables, seating approximately 200 people, with an average of £90 per table of four, not including drinks, with two sittings per evening, 6:30 to 11, that will generate approximately £7,200. Yeah. So for that one evening, they're generating, without drinks, £7,200. Compare that to a small restaurant, like a small Indian restaurant that I do, that only has 10 tables, with an average £80 per table of four, not including drinks, will only generate £1,600. Yeah. So the way I work it out is I look at how busy the restaurants are, I look at how many covers they have, I look at how much it costs for a meal. I'll read the menu in the bar area before I speak to the manager, and I will work out how much this place basically generates in the course of an evening. Mm-hmm. And then I will look at my fee based on that. So when I'm working in the small restaurant with 10 tables, with his 1,600, he's also got to pay his staff, food, electric, rates, everything else out of that. So that's not going to leave a big chunk of cash at the end of that 1,600 for that night. So I need to try and tap into that. So for that one, I used to get about £50-60 plus a free meal for me and my girlfriend, which I would take home after the gig. And it was 150 yards from my home, so I didn't have to drive there. It was a 2-minute walk. So I've got no expenditure costs that way. So I'm happy with that. And it would be on a night like a Tuesday or Wednesday when I'm not going to be turning down other gigs. Compared right. to Frankie and Benny's, who were paying me £250, but they're generating £7,000 in the course of an evening. So that £250 is a small bit of change compared to everything else I've spent out on that night. And plus, that restaurant is also open during the daytime and lunchtime and breakfast. So it's generating a lot more than just £7,600. I think at the time of writing, when I spoke to the manager, Frankie and Benny's, their target for their restaurant, the target has a daily target, minimum target, of £18,000 for Monday to Thursday, £40,000 for Friday and Saturday, and £25,000 for Sunday. Targets are broken down into breakfast, lunch, dinner, and drinks. Whereas the small independent restaurant has a minimum target of £1,000 for Sunday to Thursday and £1,800 on Fridays and Saturdays. So by knowing this information, I'm able to go, okay, if they've got this amount of money that they're making per day on their targets, then I should be able to charge a bigger fee. I'm going to be busier. I'm going to be working more. And it's relative. So when it comes to making a fee, I look at the restaurant, I look at how much they make, and then I make and you've got to be careful. If you go in too cheap, if I'd gone to Frankie and Benny's and said £50 or £100, they probably would have said no, because it's not enough. You know, these people, they want to offer quality. They don't want to offer, and this is like any gig actually, any gig you get quoted for, if you go in too cheap, you might scare the customer away.
Right, you want to go in a little bit high and bargain down if
yeah.
need be.
I think I went in at Frankie and Benny's. I think I went in about £350, and they went, "Yeah, that's quite a lot of money to spend on one evening." And I said, "Well, I can bring that down. I can bring that down, because if you're going to book me regularly twice a month, I'll bring that. I can knock that down to 250, and all of a sudden it's gone from being $700 a month. That's now gone down to $500 a month. You know, so they get a perceived value there. They say, wow, we've just saved £250 plus. £200. Sorry, plus we've got him twice a month. You know, it's a perceived value. They go, we've got a good deal off him, and he's happy with that as well. So they're more likely to go. But yeah, you've got to go in with your fee. You've got to go in and say, this is how much I want. And again, don't make it personal. A lot of people, they get, I see it a lot on the forums. People say, oh, how much should I charge for this? I don't like asking. I hate it when they ask me how much to charge. Why? When you go into a sweet shop, or not sweet shop, when you go into any shop and you go to the till, the woman at the till doesn't go, oh, that's £65 for your shopping. They just go, 65 quid, and you pay the £65. So when you speak to somebody and they go, oh, how much are you going to charge? Well, they've already sold. They're interested. Yeah, so tell them what you charge. Don't faff about it. And it's the same with the restaurants. You go in, they want to be professional, so speak to the manager, look them in the eye, be confident, and say, this is what I charge. I normally say, if you were to book me for a one-off event, you'd be looking to pay between £450 and £650. But as a restaurant, I understand that that's a big chunk of money. If you book me on a regular basis, I can knock that right down to a lower fee because I'm going to be getting regular work out of you. And that then becomes, you know, it enables you to have a surface in front of you to work from. And then gauging their reactions, go from there. You'll be surprised as well. I've gone into some restaurants and I've thought, right, they're going to knock me down here. And I've gone in with quite a high quote. And they've gone, yeah, that's great. We have one restaurant near where I live and they serve quite unusual food. They sell snake and crocodile and other things like that. And it's expensive. They do a 72-ounce steak. If you eat it within an hour, you get it for free. Yeah. I haven't done that one yet. I thought about it.
Well, you know, and I think part of you were talking about people underselling themselves and whatnot. I think part of that, or not wanting to do prices, I think part of that is people who are asking these sort of questions on what they need to charge because they're not used to telling people what they're worth. And maybe this is an advantage that I got coming from my father's owned his own business my entire life. So I've been the son of a small business owner, a family business owner. And I can't stand other people telling me what I'm worth. I can't. I want to tell you what you'll pay me because I know what I'm worth. And that kind of helps. But at the end of the day, you're absolutely right. When you go to the grocery store, they tell you what you're going to pay, and then you have the choice to pay it or not. You know.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of these guys just don't have the business experience or the business mind yet. They haven't. So many people forget the business part of show business. And it is. It's a full round business. When when you're not actually performing, you're doing other things. You're marketing. You're tracking down leads. You're preparing for another show. You're doing.
If you even look at the word show business, the business word is much bigger than the show word, and that's so true. You know, the show is just a small part of what we do. The business, the bigger word, is the bigger part of what we do. It's 50 minutes of business to do the 10 minutes of show. You know, that's how it equates to. You've got to – it's the hardest thing. So many magicians I know who have no business sense at all. You know, they don't do contracts. They don't have public liability insurance. They don't confirm – they don't even ring up to confirm with the client before the gig, you know. And I won't work with them. I won't use them because they've got no business sense, you know. And if you don't have that, then you're not going to do a good job. Yeah, you might be funny for the night. Yeah, you might do a good show for them, but it's the other things, the other parts of that that are really, really important. When you go into a restaurant, to keep it on top of the restaurants, when you go into a restaurant, going up to the tables and doing the magic is the smallest part of what I do in there. I mean, you've got to understand this is a business. So I'm not only there, and not only from my point of view, but from the restaurant point of view, I'm there to cover any mistakes in the restaurant. I'm there to keep the people occupied while they're waiting for the food. I'm there to sell drinks to the people, you know. And I don't mean go behind the bar and pour them. I mean by being, I'm a spokesperson. I'm an ambassador for the restaurant now. You know, I now work for the restaurant. So
you're there to keep them there so that they buy more. The longer they're in the restaurant and happy, the more the restaurant's going to make, which the more you're going to make. And people forget that, like, when you go out, like, everybody wants to perform for other people. And if you just want to perform for other people, go box.
Yep.
Go to something where it's free and you can walk out and you can do it. But if you're talking about going and offering stage shows, going and offering doing bar hopping, like, and actually contracting out, like, there are steps that take place. You're there for a reason. If you're having a bad day and you're upset, your friend did this, you still need to go in with a happy face and entertain guests. That's your job. You know, and you have to think of it like a job. And so many people don't want to because it's fun, and jobs aren't fun.
I split up with my wife, and she walked out, and she'd met somebody else, and she moved out. And I've got a little girl with this woman, and I was heartbroken and devastated. And 2 days after she left me, I had a wedding. And it's sort of like, you know, I've got to go, and I can't walk into that wedding going, my wife's left me. You know, I've got to close Wayne Goodman down and turn on the magician and just do the show and get through it. You know, and I can't, you know, and that's the way it is. You can't, I've turned up, I don't do it close up, but I've been quite poorly and I have to do a stage show. And so I'm thinking, right, well, I'm just not going to get anybody up on stage for this show. I don't want to give them what I've got, but I can still do the show. So I'm backstage feeling crappy. And then I'm on stage full of life, happiness, joy, come off stage, back in the car. You know, it is a business, and you have to think of it like a business. You know, you have to be professional, and that's where a lot of magicians fall down. But if you are professional, if you can do that, if you concentrate on what you're doing and you think about what you're selling, then when it comes to the fee, then it shouldn't be an issue. You know, and it shouldn't be a conflict. You know, you've got it. You sell it. You know, and it's no different to what anybody else is doing in their business life. And if you go, ooh, well, they're going to go, well, I don't want to book this guy. He doesn't even know what he's doing. Dart in a dartboard. If you go in and say, right, it's going to cost you X amount for this show, then they're going to think, well, this guy knows what he's talking about. This is what this guy charges. Other people are paying this fee, so this is what we're going to pay. Now, if they then go, ooh, that's a bit much for us, really. We don't think we can stretch our budget to that. Then you can say, okay, well, let's see what figure can we work with. Let's work around it.
Right. Absolutely. No. I was just adding on. No. You can't pay this. That's fine. I understand that. No, I work with other small businesses. What can we work out?
Maybe I could knock X amount off this, and I can do a little bit shorter, or we can look at doing it on this night, or maybe making it a bit more regular. I had one restaurant, they wanted me once a month, and I quoted them, and they went, that's a bit outside our budget, and I knew it would be, but I wanted to work this restaurant more often. So I said, well, look, how about we knock this amount off, so now it's X amount, but I'll come in every 2 weeks. And the woman went, do you know what, that would really work well for us. Brilliant. I've now got 2 nights worth of work. And let's not forget, the main reason I work in restaurants is to give out my business card. I have some here. So I work in a restaurant. These get put on every single table. Even if I don't work at the table, they get put on the table. And in some of my restaurants even, the waiting staff, they're happy to do this because they know they're getting bigger tips. When they take the bill over to the table, we'll take one of my cards and put it in the bill with them. So every table gets one of my business cards with the bill, you know, to take away. And that's lovely. You know, that's amazing, you know, feeling of, yeah, that's great. So, yeah, it's be professional, be confident, have confidence in what you're doing and confidence in who you are, and you'll be fine. I will quickly just add this on here as well. I'm more than happy to all the people who are listening to the podcast live now or when it goes on later on as a recorded thing. If you've got any questions or you've missed part of it or you want to talk more in depth about it, feel free to add me on Facebook, message me. I will be more than happy to guide you and help you in any single way that I can. I love performing. I'm very passionate about what I do. I'm very, very passionate. People who are friends of mine on Facebook will know that I have two massive loves in my life. One is my magic and one is my daughter. And I love her. So I'm not going to get into that now, but the other is magic. I'm very passionate about it. I watch magic. I love magic. It's the biggest thing in my life apart from my daughter. And it's very, you know, and so if I can help people to get working and get doing stuff and maybe pushing themselves a little bit more and pushing themselves out of their comfort zone to get out and actually do something, then I'm more than happy to help with that.
Wayne, where does Star Wars fall on that line?
I didn't show you this. Well, I'm going to tell everyone now. Me and Alex were chatting for a little while before the show started, just doing sound checks and showing off our little magic offices. I didn't show this to anyone. I have an ex-girlfriend, and we were together about 15 years ago. And she's my best friend now. I love her to bits. I love her so much. She's great. And I get on well with her husband, and her little girl is 2 days older than my little girl, so they love each other. They're best friends. And we went up there for Christmas. Me and my little girl went up there 2 days, 3 days after Christmas. And this was my Christmas present from her. Check this bad boy out. Now, I'll admit, and I don't think she can see this, so I doesn't mind saying, I have nowhere to put this at the moment. So I'm trying to find somewhere, but I love it. It's like 3 foot tall. This is proper. I love Darth Vader.
Well, and I don't know, you know they sell full-size suits of armor and stuff like that. I'm somewhat surprised, or you're almost lucky, rather, that you didn't get a full suit.
I want to make a full suit, Vader suit. I think it'd be awesome. I showed you earlier, I've got the lightsaber. I think that would be epic. It's one of those little projects. Maybe I'm 40 this year, so I'm thinking maybe I can spend the next year buying parts and making my own belt and making my own Vader costume. I think that would be pretty smart. I love it. I just love Star Wars. I cannot wait for the new films to come out. I think they're going to be epic. I think they're going to be amazing. I can't wait. And plus, my little girl. My little girl's 5.
What's up?
My little girl, she's 5. And so she loves Disney and stuff like that. And, you know, Princess Leia will become a Disney princess. So it gives me another excuse to watch it.
Well, we got, absolutely true. You're absolutely right. She will be a Disney princess. I didn't even think about that. Same with Padme. That's actually something that I'll be interested in asking you to join me on my other show that I started up. But that's a whole other thing. Something you'd said earlier, you broke it down really well, and I really liked it, the way you thought of it. For pricing, the going out and actually figuring out, say, what the restaurant makes in a night. I find that very important because it puts in perspective what you're going to ask.
A friend of mine was buying a house, and I said, "Come, we'll go out for a beer one night." And he said, "I can't tonight. I'm going to look at the house." And I said, "Well, you've been to look at the house," and he said, "Yeah, but." We went to look at it at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I want to go and look at it at 8 o'clock at night because I want to find out if it's really noisy in the area or if there's trains that go past in the evening and things like this. If there's loads of kids having fights in the street and stuff. I want to go and look at it at 9 o'clock in the morning how busy is it in the morning to get out when I'm going to work and stuff. And I'd never heard this before and I thought, wow, that makes a lot of sense. So when I came back to England and was setting up the company, I was like, well, that's what I need to do. I need to go to the restaurants at different times of the day and scope them out. You know, case the joint. I need to go in and case the place out and find out what goes on and when. When is it busy? Why is it busy at that time? What days is it dead on? Because the more information I have, the more information it shows that I've done my research. So when I speak to the manager, and I say to him, look, I know that you're really, really busy on a Thursday night because you do your steak night. He'll be like, oh my God, this guy knows what he's talking about. He's done his research. He knows that we're busy on a Thursday night. He knows that we're dead on a Tuesday. You know, it just shows that you know what you're talking about. And it doesn't take a lot. It doesn't take a lot at all. Just to make that little tiny little bit of effort will reap you rewards that you can't even imagine.
And that's actually a technique I've used, or I was taught in high school for going out and finding jobs anyway, is before you go out with your resume, you know, if you want to talk to somebody, before you go in and talk to somebody, go on their website, you know, find out their mission statement, you know, look up reviews, do whatever you can, like reconnaissance, information can only help you, it will never hurt you. And I'm very much of that mind, so when you went over the whole price scheme and really looking at it from the bar's perspective, that was just absolutely great. I think that's some of the best advice I've heard in pricing, because especially here, you're absolutely right. It's very tip heavy. If I go out to a place, I could try to negotiate out a deal for pricing, but they're probably going to want me to work for tips. That's going to be the gut instinct for most management out here. So that's the way you go about it, though, kind of having them come to you to some extent, you know, having that...
I was just going to say, if a restaurant came to me, I mean, again, I'm not overly familiar with the US way of doing things, because obviously I live over here, but, you know, if they say to you, can you work for tips, I would say, yes, okay, I'll work for tips. To begin with, I'm happy to work for tips. Yeah, it gets your foot in the door. It gets your foot under the table. Once you're in there and they can see the value that you bring to the restaurant, and if you find yourself working more and more, even to the point, I have done a restaurant just for tips, and they got to the point where they wanted me for more nights. And I said, well, okay, I can do that, but I'm going to have to charge you. I can't work just for tips. And by that point, the manager was, okay, not a problem. Because... my value was assessed. My value was known. The restaurant I work at on a Sunday, it started off 12 till 3, and then the manager said to me, and I'm charging quite a lot for this restaurant as well. And then they said, can you do two shows on a Sunday? Can you do 12 till 3, and then 4 till 7? And I said, yes, of course I can do that. That's great. That's brilliant for me. So I'm now getting a double bubble, and I'm already in the venue. I can see that Laura wants to ask a question.
Yeah, right. There is two questions, and they kind of intermingle. One we kind of already talked about, and hers relates. The question
can I just say, hi, Laura. Hello.
The question in the polls was, can you turn a table walk or a table hopping into a dinner show? And then Laura's question, you're probably looking at it because I have to go over to it, but it was, what about selling a dinner show to make a percentage on the door? So on dinner shows in generally, what do you have to say?
Okay. Dinner shows, okay, from this point of view, if I'm, first of all, turning the table hopping into a dinner show, the way I work when I work anyway is I don't just work to one table. I work, and I'm quite lucky that a lot of the restaurants I work in have sections. So, especially on a Sunday, they're like enclosed sections. So I can go into one bit and only those tables can see me. And very often I'll be working one table and then I notice that all the tables are watching me and I'll just step back a little bit and I'll work to the whole section as a whole. And I have tricks on me that I can do. It turns what we call a parlor show. It turns into like a parlor show. But I try not to, if I can. I always try to involve other tables, but I try to keep it. So if I'm doing this table A, say table one, and then it becomes a show, I'll still incorporate a lot of table one because they were the table that I was at, and so I want them, and I'll use them for the tricks, etc. For turning it into a dinner show where you make a percentage of door tickets. Not something I've ever actually come across, and I have had venues where they'll say to me, can we do them? Like there's a restaurant near where I live that's on the riverside, and it does a Sunday lunch. It's very, very nice, and I have done that with them where they've sold tickets and then they've given me either a fee or a percentage of how many tickets are sold. With talks of doing that, I was there at Halloween, and then we said maybe in this year we'd look at maybe doing it over the summer. So on a Saturday lunchtime, maybe having Magic Afternoon. But I don't think that's going to happen because they're now doing weddings, to be fair. And I think they're going to take over with the weddings more than anything else. But yeah, it's a lot of the restaurants that I work at, they don't sell tickets for dinners. It's, you know, it's just a normal restaurant as people come in. But I mean, yeah, if you can, if you've got a restaurant that wants to do a dinner show, or you can suggest a dinner show to them and say, you know, have you thought about doing a show here where you invite in a bunch of people, you charge them a set fee for the show? And I'd say, yeah, go for it. It's once you're in the restaurant, I'll be honest with you, once you're in the restaurant and you're working the restaurant, and the manager has your value assessed and they know how much you do and what you do for them, I think you can pretty much suggest anything. I get on very well with my managers, and I speak to them before and after my shift. I do tricks for them. And one of my managers, the one I do for the Sunday, she's getting married in Spain later on this year, and I'm flying out to do her wedding in Spain. And so I get on very well with my managers. So if I wanted to suggest something like that, then I think they might have to say no because they work, their boss wouldn't allow it, or whatever. But I think it would be, you know, it would be something they would consider. Maybe I'll try it. I'll try that, Laura. I might ask, and I'll let you know how it goes. But yeah, if you can make a suggestion. Plus, as well, of course, if you're making suggestions like that to the manager, it shows that you're thinking about the restaurant, that you're thinking about ways of bringing in more people. Like, for instance, over Christmas, I love mulled wine. I love mulled wine. And I love Jack Daniels, and I love Amaretto. And I was talking to a friend of mine, and she said, "We've got to try this." And if anyone listening, if you want to try this, it is the best. But you get a glass, a tall glass. You pour in some. You poured in some amaretto, like a double shot, and you topped it up with hot apple juice, and it was a really refreshing alternative to mulled wine. And I happened to mention this to the manager of the restaurant, and on a Sunday while I was there, it was Wayne's Wizard cocktail, you know, and so it generated, they sold a load of them at the bar, people bought them, generating more income for the bar just on something I had suggested to them. So, you know, if you make suggestions to the manager and it's something that's going to help generate more business for the restaurant, then, yeah, I don't see why that wouldn't work. I see Laura's put that my tickets included dinner and dessert and a show. Again, yeah, if the venue is set up for that and the venue can do that, then I would say, yeah, definitely suggest it and try and make it happen. But again, don't be disappointed if they turn it down.
Right. Well, and out here, it's I don't know how it is in England, but or in the UK in general, Europe. But out here, a lot of the times, restaurants don't have stages, or at least areas where they're like, some restaurants will have like spots for conventions where they can wall that section off. But yeah, most of them, they're very open, very, you're in front of everybody, and it's rarely that rare that a restaurant has a stage. Normally, bars will have stages because they will double as venues.
Yeah.
But on it's that, yeah, I thought it might be similar. So it's really kind of hard to go into a full show if you're not waiting kind of people, and it's a lot to go into. If
there
you're
going, are some
pick one or the other, you know what I'm saying?
If you look at a venue that maybe is a wedding venue that has a restaurant, so hotels, places like that have a restaurant, but also it's like a wedding venue, they will have an area where there is a stage or a raised section for when they have the disco or the band for the wedding, etc. And again, they might roll them out. But in a normal family kind of restaurant, then yeah, every space is taken up because the more tables they can get in, the more covers they have, the more money they make. So unless it's if it's like a jazz bar or a music bar that has tables in it, then yes, they might have an area that you could perform in. But yeah, a lot of places, yeah, they're not going to have that. So again, yeah, you need to assess where you're working and look at it and go, right, that's what I want to do. That's how I want to do it. And then you can speak to the manager and say, you know, what do you think to that? How do you think this is something we could do in the restaurant? And then they'll either say, yes, that's great, let's make that happen, or they'll say, yeah, that's not really going to work here.
Right. Tommy Ellison wrote in, and since you just kind of touched on it a little bit with one of your the managers getting married from one of your restaurants, he was wondering, do you perform at wedding receptions a lot?
Yes, that's the other side of my work. Mostly from May till October sort of time, most of my money comes from weddings. And yeah, it's a, you know, it's not that dissimilar to restaurants, really. You know, you're moving around groups of people. Your priorities have shifted when you do a wedding, but but again, you're around the tables. It's a bit of a different situation here because you're paid to go to every table, so you're not going to get turned away from too many tables because, you know, they're there. You know, it's part of what the day is all about, as opposed to being a restaurant where people have just come in. It's not that dissimilar, to be honest. Weddings are great. I love weddings.
Well, I haven't had a chance to do any weddings yet. And I would imagine. I always hear, you know, try to perform to the bride and groom as often as possible, stuff like that. But that's the only advice I'd ever really been given.
No, actually, I disagree with that. With weddings, one of my jobs when I'm at a wedding is actually to keep everyone else occupied so the bride and groom can get round everybody. They can do the things they have to do. So I actually said to the bride and groom, I have some special tricks that I only do for you, like the anniversary waltz or I can't think what his name is now, the German guy with the mustache. What's his name? That's going to really bug me. He did the spoon around. What's that?
The mustache?
Yeah, hold on. You'll know him. Hold on one second. Hold on. I'm not going anywhere. I'm still here. Some of you guys can wear my pajamas. Alex Hecklau.
I should have known that.
Alex Hecklau. Yeah, my mind's going. It really is. He's got a really nice thing called Two Fusion, where he tears two cars up and puts them back together again, and it's lovely. It's really, really nice. And I'll say to the bride and groom, I will come and I will do some special magic for you, but I'm going to make sure the guests see me, and that gives you an opportunity to get round everybody, and that works much, much better. They're too busy with other stuff to worry about what I'm doing, and then I'll make them feel special. They'll be the last table I do, and then while I'm getting the massive round of applause for the bride and the groom, I can then get out and go on to my next one. We should do one on wedding magic. Can I tell you my favourite wedding story?
Yes, please do.
My favourite wedding story. So this happened 18 months ago. So I turn up at this wedding, and I always get there early. So I'm in the car park, and I'm having a quick game of Scrabble on my iPad, waiting to go in, and I see one of the best men or page boys come out. And he's looking, and so I get out of the car, and he says, "Are you the magician?" And I went, "Yes, that's me." And there's always a problem. It's the bride and groom have taken longer with the photographs, or there's a delay with the food, or something's happened. And so he comes and says, "We've got a problem," and he's stressing. And I'm like, "Don't worry, I've heard it all before. What's the problem?" And I'm ready for him to say, "The bride and groom haven't come back from their photographs yet, or there's something's happened." And I'm ready to say, "Don't worry about that. I'm here now, I'll make everyone happy, lots of jokes and magic, and let's go and make the place special." And he says, "There's been a bit of a situation. The bride's mother has smashed a glass in the face of the groom's mother. She's been arrested. The other mum's been The other mum's been taken to hospital. The two dads have got into a fight and have headbutted each other and broken noses, and they've both been arrested. And there's a bit of atmosphere in the venue, and can I come and make everyone a bit happier, please?" So I go in, I'm thinking, what the hell have I got into here? So I go in, and there's two rows of tables, and this side is all the bride's family, and this side is all the groom's family. So I go over to one side, and I do some magic, and they're really into it, and they're going, "Yeah, this is amazing." I go across to the next side, and they went, "If you're entertaining that family, you only do that side of the room." So I worked one side of the venue. The best man came up and said, "Oh, that's better than we could have expected." Gave him my money. I did about half an hour, and I went home. the most bizarre situation I've ever been in.
Yeah, you know, I'll be perfectly honest. I would have just kind of stared at him and gone, yeah, let me do that for you. I'm sorry.
I'll be honest, the five tables I did was excellent. They were lovely.
I'm sorry, I have a birth or death to be at. I'll be right back.
Yeah.
I have a freckle. I need to go. Yeah, no, that's really, wow, man, that's ridiculous. That's hard to come back for, but you did it, you know, and that goes back to it being part of a job, though, man. You did it, and that's the important part. Tommy wrote in again, why do you think that wedding receptions are so popular in the UK and not in the US? Which isn't necessarily true. I mean, I didn't have a big reception, but I also didn't have money for a big reception at my wedding. Like, we barely had money for the wedding. So, we didn't, but I know tons of people who have, like, big weddings, and, like, the reception is, like, 2 hours, 3 hours long, and all that stuff. I sat in a buffet for my reception and ate crab.
Nice. You know what? I think weddings are... I got married, and admittedly, my marriage didn't last very long. But when I got married, it was quite a small affair. We had 20 magicians there who were all my friends, and some of her friends and family, and there was probably 60, 70 people, the maximum for the whole day. But it's a very personal thing. And I think in the UK at the moment, people, how can you put this? They want, it's their last big party, you know. We've just introduced over here the prom. Over the last sort of like 5 to 10 years, the prom has become bigger and bigger and bigger. And now most schools have a prom, whereas in America, that's been the case for many, many years. I think the concept of making things bigger and bigger and bigger, such as in America, I mean, America is known for the big buildings. You look at Vegas, and it's all very extravagant hotels and casinos, and you look at, and that's starting to spread over here now. Casinos, rather than just taking over a building, I've noticed a few casinos in my area are having special buildings made for them, you know, in the designs that they want. So it's kind of spreading that kind of feel of getting bigger. I think weddings are the same thing. I think they're, people look at them and they think, well, this is our last big party. Let's make it big. Let's have a big splash. After this, over here, I mean, I was talking to somebody the other day, and they've just got married, and she's a friend of mine, and she said, well, now I'm married, now we've got to have the kids. And it's sort of like there's an order of these things. So you have the big party, everyone's there, and then you can start thinking about babies, and you know, then the party stop, obviously.
Just wrote in, he was specifically, I guess, talking about having a magician at the reception, not the reception themselves.
Well, this kind of falls in with it, you know, this kind of falls in with it. The weddings get bigger, the weddings are more extravagant, you know, and over the last, again, over the last few years, you've seen more things spreading into the reception. You've got things like photo booths and chocolate fountains, and these things are great, but they're kind of like stamped in the corner, or they're there and you can use them or you not use them. And so a magician is kind of like a nice, it's an interactive thing that happens throughout the day. When I sell my weddings to people, again, I think very carefully about what I'm going to say to the client. Like being in a restaurant, I think about why am I there? What am I there to do? And that's how it's like. I think because I started off years ago doing trade shows as well. I always think about the point of sale, the most prevalent reason for me being there. So when I sell myself to a restaurant, I sell myself to a wedding, it is because I have genuinely thought about the reasons why I should be there. If I was to say to them, wow, you're spending a load of money, why not have something else as well, they're not going to book me. But if I say to them, well, this is going to enhance your day, because one of the big things I say is, you know, the bride and groom always take longer with the photographs than they thought they were going to. So That's a time when your guests are left on their own, neglected almost. So why don't you have a magician there? By having a magician there, if you are 10 minutes late or 15 minutes late getting back to the reception, no one's going to notice. You know, no one's going to realise there's been a delay. You can take your time, relax. And when I meet with people, again, very much when I meet with people for weddings, it's very much like the restaurants. My job in that meeting is to put them at ease. The manager of the restaurant, the bride, is to put them at ease. So when I go in there, especially in restaurants, especially with weddings, they don't want to think that I'm going to be another headache that they're going to have to deal with. So if I can go to them and say, look, this is what I'm going to do. I do this all the time. You know, I make them feel that they know that they can just let me get on with it, and I will go and I will get on with it. And if there's a problem, I'll deal with it. If there's a – God, I sound like MC Hammer, I'll solve it. Check out the DJ where the DJ revolves it. They just want to know that you're going to – so, I think that – well – yeah.
Well, because he wrote in afterwards. He said, "I recently worked a bridal fair and got a good response, but people seem to have the perception, at least here in America, that a magician is for kids and balloon animals. And really, I think that that's true. A lot of people see are seeing the typical sponge balls. They're seeing the guy with the top hat and the rabbit." And they're seeing children's
magicians. Same perception over here. It's the same perception over here. What you've got to do, the big comment I get at wedding fairs is people will say, we haven't got many children at the wedding. And I go, oh, good. That's good to know. Brilliant. Because let me show you what I can do for the adults. I'm not there for the children. Let me show you what I can do for the adults. And then I will do a couple of quick tricks on them at the wedding fair and show them. And as well, with the wedding fair, I will say this, if you do wedding fairs, don't worry too much about the bride. Impress the husband-to-be or the in-laws who are there, because they're probably the ones who are paying for it. And so if the mum's there, one of the things I always do is when I'm speaking to a couple at wedding fair is I'll do a peek of a business card, and I'll get them to write down the date of their wedding, and then I'll fold up the card and rip it up, and I'll peek the date of their wedding. And then I'll do a small mind reading thing where I say, you know, think about how the trees are going to look. Are they going to be bare because it's in the winter? Are they going to be full of bloom because it's in the summer? Ah, okay. So these ones are, it's just starting to bloom. Your wedding's going to be in the springtime because I can see the trees are just blooming and there's lots of colours and actually there's animals scattering. And I can see now that it's quite warm. So I'm going to say this is like May, June time. It's going to be June time. It's going to be quite warm. You've got your short sleeves on under your jacket. You're looking very smart there, by the way. And so I'll make it all very personal to them. And that gets me my wedding. To be honest, that one trick is the one that they all talk about. He guessed my wedding day. Well, I didn't guess it. I read your mind, love. But And taking it back to the restaurants, if you can do that in the restaurant, you know, I one thing I'll do with the manager, if I get a meeting with the manager and he wants to see a trick, and sometimes you'll be in the restaurant and the manager will be very excited and he'll be like, oh my God, I love magic. I say, okay, let's do a trick. Go and get one of the menus. Bring the menu over here. Yeah. Look at the menu and choose something off that menu. Something you'd really like to eat. What's your favourite thing on the menu? And then so he'll choose something. And I'll get him to write it down. And again, I'll either tear the card up or I'll put it in a peek wallet. And then I'll just peek it. I did do one restaurant. I was talking to the regular at the bar, and I was saying, so what's good here then? And she said to me, she went, wow. The manager loves the chicken burger with the Hawaiian sauce. And I went, oh, really? I went, yeah, oh, God, he has that almost every day. So when I'm talking to the manager and he asked me to do a trick, I didn't even have him write it down. I said, think about your favorite thing that you eat in the restaurant. And then I told him what it was. Now, he would have gone to the kitchen staff and said, did you tell him? And they would have gone, no. Thank you very much, Mr. Mind Reader. You know, and it's just using the situation to your advantage, really, I suppose. But, yeah, if you can make yourself stand out a little bit, and again, it's just being confident to do something maybe a bit different, and yeah, make it work for yourself.
No, absolutely.
Tommy's getting excited on here, isn't he?
What was that?
Tommy, he's taken over the whole thread.
Oh well, there's that's because there's a few there's like three or four threads going plus the event, so I'm trying to skip around to as many places as possible to ask as many questions. We are at the 1.5 hour mark right now.
Good to go. If you feel good to go, I'm enjoying it.
I might have to take a short intermission myself, temporarily here shortly. Actually, I have one. If I can take a quick intermission myself, I have a good one here. If you want to start vamping on that, and I will leave and return just temporarily. I think it's something that you could probably go on.
I don't know if it's any use to you.
What's up?
I don't know if it's any use to you, but there is an empty bottle behind you.
Yeah, right. That's actually that would be difficult to do, considering that's a Japanese soda.
Oh, okay.
It closes through a marble that rolls out. It's a whole other thing, but you're absolutely right though. That would be generally. what kind of restaurants to approach would be the question. If you want to talk about that, I can be back in 2 seconds.
Yeah. Okay. I'll do that.
All right, I'll be right back.
But let's all hide. So, what kind of restaurants to approach? I would say for me. I'm very comfortable when I work. I'm very comfortable working with families and children. I have children. I have a child, and I've always been comfortable working around children. So a family restaurant for me, you've got to look at it yourself. You know, if you don't like children, or you're one of those performers that your kind of performance isn't going to be suitable for doing in front of children, or you don't think that it's that kind of environment for your show, then you want to stay clear of those kind of restaurants. But if you've got, and there are restaurants, I mean, I have a friend of mine, he's quite into Gothic magic, and he works at a restaurant that's, it's not upmarket, but it's a bit of an alternative kind of a restaurant, and they're very proactive on having a lot of fun in the restaurant. So he goes in there, they don't have children in there, it's not that kind of place. And he goes in there, and his stuff works very well. He's had to adapt his act for it a little bit, but it works very well. Oh, my God, that was fast. How did you do that? But like I said, I'm very comfortable working with children. So for me, working in a family restaurant, if there are children at the table, it's not going to bother me. I don't just work to the tables with children on. I work to every table. But I will go over and I will do some magic at this table, and I will go over. I'm not going to turn this into a dealer den, but I have hopefully have a new effect coming out with Alakazam Magic sometime this year, which is my version of Sam the Bellhop, but with cards with a story deck for children. It's got lots of gags in it for the adults, but it's aimed at the children at the table, but the adults enjoy it as well. And so. Yeah, that's something that's coming out later on this year, hopefully, and something I'm very excited about. But I have tricks on me that are suitable for the kids, so I do sponge balls. You know what? I do sponge balls for the kids, and it's the parents who gasp loudest for them as well. And I have tricks that are exclusively for the adults, and I kind of I'm not a kids entertainer, I'm not an adult entertainer, I'm a family entertainer. So when I go in, I have that mindset in, and I go in and I think, well, okay. So when I go to a restaurant, equally at ease with any. I work restaurants that have no children in. I have restaurants that do have children in. I have restaurants that have specialty themes. There's a restaurant near me, actually, and they only book me once a year, and that's at Halloween. And they book me for Halloween magic, and they turn the restaurant, the whole menu changes, all the names become like sausages will become dislocated fingers, and they change the names of everything to make them more horror and gothic. And I go in and I do razor blades and stuff like that. I don't have blood pouring out of my mouth, but I do the razor blades, and I do stuff which is a bit more off-keter, but it fits in with what they want me to do. How was that? You're back! You just appeared a minute ago. You just appeared. The screen was empty, and then you were just sat there. I didn't even see you come in. It was kind of like a boom like that. I have no idea how you did that. You should market that. That's an amazing effect.
I'm going to let you in on a little secret of television magic. Camera tricks.
Really? I don't believe that.
Not for a second.
I can't believe you did a camera trick on me. I can't. That's amazing. It got me. Amazing.
I wouldn't do that, do you, man? But yeah. I can't even remember the point I was getting was about to get on with because of the little segue there. So that's my fault.
What's the next question? Have we got another one?
I had a couple more before I wanted to kind of roll things up. Two of them are really close in, but okay. we've almost gotten all the questions. So I want to try to get all the questions before we go, and I think we can do it in the next half an hour. This is going to be kind of a two-part. One is when is it the right time to approach a table, and the other is how long should one spend at a table?
Okay, so for me, when I'm selling it to the restaurant and I'm talking to the manager, this is a question that comes up quite a lot. How long am I going to do at the tables and stuff? You really need to. I'll deal with the how long first of all. So you need to speak to the venue and find out how long it takes. Well, actually, no, let me go to the other part first. For me, the best time to go to the table, if I can, is once they've ordered their food and they're waiting for the food. If you hit the table as soon as they come in, A, it's a bit pushy. They'll give them a chance to sit down and order some drinks. And B, you're going to hold up the kitchen who are waiting for the order to get the food on. So for me, the best time to go over is once they've made the order, I will then go over and do a 10-minute spot, say. But it depends on the restaurant. One restaurant I work at, they cook everything for fresh, and it's like a steakhouse. So it's all cooked very fresh food, fresh vegetables, and they're cooked to order. Nothing is pre-cooked. Everything's cooked to order. So the people know this, so they know they're going to have a 10-15 minute wait for the food, and it's a given. Whereas some restaurants, like the Frankie and Benny's, a lot of the food is pre-cooked and they just zap it in a microwave. So I know that, or they just reheat it on the grill. So by speaking to the manager and finding out how the restaurant works, I can then know that, say in my Sunday restaurant one, I know that I've got about an 8-minute window from the time they take their order to the time the food comes out. So I'm going to try and get in there in that 8-minute window to do my bit. Now, if I can't, I'll come back after they've had the main course and while they're waiting for dessert to come or to take dessert order. I don't tend to go back after dessert because then you're holding up them leaving and then turning around the table for the next sitting. So I try and make it that kind of period. So once the order's been taken, I will go over. Again, something else you can do here as well is by being in with my waiting staff, they would actually promote me to the table before I even go over. So once they've taken the order, they'll just happen to say something like, oh, we have a magician here today. If you would like to see some magic, I'll get him to come over and see you. Now, what this does, it makes it look like the waitress is doing them a favor for them. And so it enhances their tip at the end of it because they've said, I will get him to come over to you. He loves working my tables and things like this. And it just makes it a lot more personal. And then it becomes, you know, it's like, oh, my mate kind of involving me into the family fold of the whole thing. How long should you do at the table? Yeah, again, you need to speak to the venue, find out how long it's going to take, and then gauge your response on that. So for me, as soon as the food starts coming over, you should start wrapping up. One of the questions I did see as well, which kind of comes into this, one of the questions I did see on one of the threads was the other day was, do I perform the same tricks at the same tables every single time? And my answer to that is no, based, and that kind of comes into why there. I have a number of effects on me, and I'm always doing new stuff. It makes it different for me. It makes every time they're going to come in, they're going to see something different. And it also means that if I'm halfway through a set and the food comes out, I can then stop and then just move away from the table. I'm not tied into, damn, I need to finish this because I've still got that woman's ring in my ring flight that I borrowed at the beginning of the set, and now I'm trying to do something over here with this. So by doing everything and concluding everything very quickly, I can move things around. So if I have to move, I can move. If I don't have to move, I don't have to move.
Along the same lines, another question we had was, what effects do you recommend for table hopping? And I think the broader question here is, what kind of effects? Do you do you recommend? Because you, when you talk to, like, now, for example, you may not want to do multiplying sponge balls if they already have their food or their, like, appetizers, because where are those sponge balls going to go? Right onto the table, right onto the floor. Nobody wants to dig around for those.
Some of the things I have that I recommend, and this goes over to the weddings as well, actually. When I'm working at a wedding reception, obviously I've got to go to every table. So if they're eating their food, that table still has to be seen. Now, some people don't like working while people are eating, but I have tricks I can do in my hands. They can just watch while they're eating. So I sometimes you'll have a table in a restaurant and they'll say, oh, can we see some magic? And I'll say, yeah, sure, I'll wait till you're finished. And they'll go, oh, we're getting straight off. Can you do something quickly for us now? Okay, if they're asking for it, no problem. So I will do the bill switch, which happens here in front of my face, well away from their food. All they've got to do is give me the note. They give me the note, I fold it up, it turns into a dollar. I then fold it back up again, turn it back into a £10 note and give it back to them. And so it happens here. It's very visual. The whole table can watch it while they're eating. So I think you have to think about what's going to happen while you're in a restaurant. I always say to people, most restaurants don't have any table space. So things like, and every restaurant I work in, I haven't got room to take a table around with me. Where you are, it may be different. And if it is, then brilliant. Do that if you can, if you want to. But for me, that doesn't work. So I can't do cups and bowls. I can't do chop cup. I can't do anything that requires any table space, because pretty much every single restaurant I do has no table space. The most I do is I'll turn a wine glass upside down, and on the bottom part of the wine glass, I will put the mystery box, and that will go on top of the wine glass, or the bottom of the wine glass. It has to be, everything has to be containable on me, in my hands. And like you say, if you're going to do sponge balls halfway through a meal, those sponge balls are going to end up in the food, and then you're going to end up paying for a new meal because, you know, you're the one who's messed it up. Right. A little bit of thought about it, and that's all it takes, is just a little bit of thought. What have you got in your magic set, in your magic box? What have you got that you can do in that situation? And you'll be amazed. You'll sit down and you'll go, you know what, actually, I do this all the time, and actually that's not going to be suitable for this show. And so always have a backup, something else you can throw in there instead.
Well, you know, and like, for example, you do, you said you do the mystery box. I mean, that's a great way to involve people. And the worst thing that they're going to have to do is sign a card.
Yeah.
You know, anything else can be a vicious card. You could do a 5, 6, 8 phase of vicious card routine, and with the mystery box, and really call it a day. That could be your entire thing. But yeah, it's involving them staying within the context of the atmosphere, and remembering where you're at. You know, why are they there?
It's what's it called? What's that word? I'm trying to think of the term. When you were in a car, but you know your surroundings. I can't think what they call that now.
Being aware. Yeah.
Spatial awareness, you know, just being aware of the space around you, and just being aware of all that, just knowing your location and your venue. And again, you know, a little bit of research is all this takes. All you need to do is go in a couple of times and go, you know what, that trick I do isn't going to work in here, but I have got a trick that I could put in its place, and that will work in here. And by doing that, you then, be, you know, and it's good for you as well. It's good to mix it up a little bit. Do something you don't normally do. I try to always have at least one trick on me that I've never done before. For me, if nothing else, for me. Because after doing my trick so many times, I don't want to look bored. I don't want to look tired. So by mixing it up with something brand new or something I've never done before, it keeps me fresh, it keeps me alert, and it breaks in another trick. You know, you can work a wedding, and you can take a new trick into there that, you know, you're breaking in, and do it 6 times. I can take the same trick into a residency and do it 25 times, you know, including doing it at the bar, doing it for the staff, doing it for the kitchen staff, just doing it and banging 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 it. And then by the end of the night, you've got something really worked. Beginning of the night, not so good. End of the night, completely done. And that's really important. Keep yourself fresh. Keep yourself, you know, working on new stuff time.
Right, and you know, I mean, like for example, even some of the stuff I'll do, I do the same way just about every time, and I've done since I learned them. I try to take and change little things. I try to leave sections where I can be different. I try to maybe if I'm doing I do a coin routine, where it's like a coin flight, but not more or less. Instead of doing it the way I was taught, I'll just halfway through it, I'll move into a completely different set of sleights and routines, and just that change is refreshing, and it's nice. It's nice to break out of the monotony of doing the same thing all the time. I know they talk about guys being able to do the same 8 tricks their entire career, but I think they're talking about people that could do that, you know, in the 40s and 30s when television wasn't a thing and radio and you couldn't, like, get on YouTube. Now everybody's seen everything, and when in doubt, you know, they can go look it up. So you have to kind of constantly reinvent yourself in order to stay fresh.
There are people over here, I know, and I mean, probably the most famous is Faye Presto, who is a London magician, and she's known for Bottle for the Table and a couple of similar effects, and that's been her, you know, her bread and butter material really for the last 30 years. I know she was one of the first people to ever do table magic, you know, in England, was one of the first people to really break the restaurant scene, and so she's very well respected in that, and very well respected in the magic community for that, and her own community and where she lives, you know, she's known for it. But I seriously doubt that's the only thing she does. That's her signature stuff. We all have our signature stuff, but you know, that's so she's known for that. So they, but yeah, there are some people who do the same stuff over. But I doubt that's the only stuff. I'm sure she does stuff, other stuff for herself as much as, you know, for the audience as well.
Well, I'm sure even her signature stuff she plays with. I mean, heck, I've heard Freebird a half a million times, and it was all different. Even when it was played by Lynyrd Skynyrd.
Yep. Good song, by the way. Good song. Good choice. Good choice of song for that.
But yeah, most recognizable. But you mean you hear? I mean, everybody knows the bass song that everybody. You know, I've heard the live version a half a million different ways, and that's just you do kind of have to keep it fresh. And again, you know, that's the nice thing about having so many different audiences every night is that. So what if you mess up? Move on to something else. You know, we all have our different ways. Like I'm self-deprecating. That's part of my bit. So like I can just call myself a piece of crap and move on, and then that be the end of it. You laugh, I laugh, the toaster laughs. You know, everybody's happy.
I do. I do a lot of self-deprecating comedy. I was just never very good at it.
What was that?
I did a lot of self-deprecating comedy, but I was never any good at it. Sorry, I couldn't resist that one. I do apologize.
Oh, that's great. All right, so we're 15 minutes off. I have a question. I have two more questions that I think I'd like to end with. But we have currently quite a few. We have a few viewers. We had a couple of things we were talking about giving away. You had a couple of PDFs. You were talking about launching off, and we've had a lot of good questions. So, tell you what we'll do. Go ahead and I'm going to drop a link in the description below where we're doing most of this stuff. You're going to email info at believeinmagicplace.com, and we'll just raffle off those. We'll do message the word restaurant to info at believeinmagicplace.com. And from that, we'll go ahead and choose a winner or two, and we'll send over. What are we sending over?
But what I've got, my first publications that I wrote was a joke book of one-liners. They're not all mine. I will put that straight in there. I have a. Actually, I have it here. Oh my goodness! This hasn't been out for a while. This is a one of three Leave of Arch files that I have. And this one is, they're all full chock-a-block full with one-liners and two-liner jokes, literally hundreds and hundreds and thousands of jokes. And so about 6 years ago, I wrote a joke book called The Comedy Magician's Joke File, 180 very usable, workable one-liners. And that was quickly followed by Volume 2, and then recently we published Volume 3. And then I did all three books as one book, unedited. It's the three books with the intros in there and everything else just stuck together into one book. So we can give away, you know, three or four of them if you want to, as PDFs. Okay. It's retail value of about $40, about £20. So if anybody, you know, if you want to, like, say info, do the email and send it over, and we'll pick two or three or four or five winners, and I'll email them over a copy of the joke book.
Woo!
All right. About 500 gags in the complete book, all very workable. I had a load of joke books, and oh, here we are. Alex Borton has already emailed over. He's very keen to win. That's you.
That's me.
What am I doing? I'm looking at it going, cool, he's keen, isn't he? So there's the email is on the thread there. So if you send the your name and your email address over, and then we'll pick some winners, and yeah, nice little gag book for you.
Absolutely.
I was getting excited, and I thought they're already on it. They're already on it. Come on, Tommy. Where's your vote, Tommy?
I went ahead and posted the email address in the description below. So again, that's info@believeinmagicplace.com. Go ahead and email over restaurant, and we'll see what kind of viewership, what kind of messages we get and whatnot. Maybe we'll just give a few of these away. So we'll take a look over who views and who drops it in. Maybe we'll raffle one off. Maybe we'll give five or six of them away. We'll see what. Yeah. We'll see what happens. We'll just off the cuff, man. Off the cuff.
Let's just rock and roll, son. Let's rock and roll.
Let's get crazy with this. All right. So we got two more before we go away. There's one that I've been saving for the end because I thought it would be a really nice thing to end this discussion on. But before that, you kind of touched on it a little bit. And I want to go back right before we end, back to the business side of things.
Okay.
There was one more big question about the business side, and it says, how does strolling magic benefit the restaurant's bottom line? And I thought you'd probably be one of the best people to answer that.
So how does it benefit the restaurant's
bottom line? The restaurant's bottom line.
Okay, so basically, what does it do for the restaurant? What does right. it bring to the restaurant? Okay, again, I talk about this in the restaurant book, and this is your POI. This is these are the points you're going to make to the restaurant as to why, you know, you should be there. Every part of a restaurant, every part of a business has to justify itself. And so if something isn't working, let's say for instance we weren't magicians. Let's say our job was to build boxes, cubes, and one side of the cube was cut slightly differently, like this, say, for instance, then when the cube is finished, it's going to have this weird bit sticking out the side. And so then you slice it off and you make it flush and then you have a nice cube. So businesses are always trying to cut away the bits that aren't needed. And it's a continual process. They'll cut away the unneeded bits to make it as flush as it can be and compacting it down. But they're not scared of expansion either. So what am I going to bring to the restaurant would be, well, it's very simple, really. First of all, my job is to generate business for the restaurant. So they can advertise, this is at the beginning, so they can advertise me for weeks before the event that we have a magician coming in on this date or every Friday or every Tuesday or now it's going to be Magic Mondays or whatever they're doing with the rest with you, they can advertise that. And so now they've got a product, they've got something that they can actually tangible that they can go, guys, you've got to come in for this. And they can say to people who come in every Friday, make sure you come in on a Tuesday because we've got this magician going to be here. It's going to be amazing. So that's the first thing. So it's something tangible they can actually advertise. It's going to generate business for them. People are going to come in because it's something different, something unique. Then on top of that, you're a problem solver. So if there is a problem, if there is a difficult customer, or there is a problem in the kitchen, or there is a mass of orders, then you can go over to those tables and keep them occupied, keep them entertained until the food comes to their table. Or, for instance, in Frankie and Benny's, I'm normally there for 3 hours. The first 2 hours are spent around the table. The last hour, the busiest hour, I don't go anywhere near the tables. I only work in the bar area, because the bar area is rammed full of people who have been told there's a 20-minute wait, there's a 30-minute wait, there's a 40-minute wait for the table. I will go in there and I will work around the people in the bar and I'll have a laugh and a chat and I'll get lots of laughter and applause in the bar area. But the people who are waiting for their table, and all they've got to do is sit there and just drink. And it gets very boring and some people will leave. When I go in there, I'm not holding up the restaurant anymore. I'm now entertaining solely the bar people. And so I provide a solution to the problem. I give them a reason for staying and waiting. There's a purpose for me to be there. I encourage repeat custom. People will come back to see me. One of my favorite things is I like to meet people at the door when they come into my Sunday restaurant, because a lot of the time people will come in and say, ah, the magic man's here. And the manager is the host. They're on the door. They hear this. They hear this a lot. Ah, the magic man's here. I had one lady walk in last week and say, I saw on Facebook that you're going to be here today, and so we booked a table. So now they've booked a table, and they've just told the manager they've booked a table because I'm there. And all these things, while they're great for my ego, they're better for the business, and not my business, for the restaurant business. Right. Like I said, I'm an ambassador for the restaurant. So every single thing I do has to benefit the restaurant. And again, a little bit of thought, all you've got to do is sit down with a pen and paper, turn the TV off, turn off Facebook, and write on the paper or write on your iPad, whatever you write on. Just think about what you can bring to that restaurant. What benefit do they have for booking you? And after 5-10 minutes of writing stuff down, you'll be amazed at what you come out with. Your value to the restaurant is infinite, because you can adapt. As a magician, you should be able to adapt and you know, overcome. I was watching Heartbreak Ridge last night, so adapt, overcome. That's all you got to do. No, but you can adapt and you can help with almost. I've had unbelievable situations I've been put into restaurants, and I've been able to help them with it. We had a lady come in with her family, and her little girl tripped on the door and fell over, and she scuffed her knee, like kids do. Every kid does it, yeah? This little girl did it. She was coming into the restaurant, and she was crying. I went over, and all I did, I didn't do any magic, actually. I went to the host desk. I got one of the restaurant balloons. I blew it up with the helium. I put the cord on it. I took it over, and I gave the little girl a balloon. And I started making her laugh by asking her silly questions. She was about 6 or something. You know, how many boyfriends have you got? Are you married? You know, that kind of, all those silly kid gags that you do. I did all those on the little kid. She was laughing. But I did it so the manager didn't have to do it, so the waiting staff could get on with their jobs. That's what I'm there to do. I'm there to resolve these things. Go over, had a bit of a laugh with them, and all of a sudden, I then say, I'm the magician, I'll come and do some magic at your table, and I'm Mr. Nice Guy. So when they are leaving, and they do say, the manager goes over and says, oh, is her knee okay? They'll go, oh my God, Wayne was excellent. He really made us feel special. You know. And I get hundreds of emails every week off people that I always forward to the restaurant, from people saying, we saw you, we want to book you, we saw you were great. And again, it's great for the ego, but for me, it's more important for the business, because it really overshadows everything else, that, you know, that's what I do for the restaurant. And I tell them to go on TripAdvisor now. I mean, we're living in an era now where we have these things like TripAdvisor and review sites, but most restaurants have a big chain restaurants will have a reviews page where you can go on and write your reviews and they put it up, or Twitter. I'll say, go on Twitter, hashtag Frankie and Benny's or F&B, and tell everyone that, you know, that you really enjoyed the magic and things like this. And all this just adds to my value to the restaurant. How's that for an answer?
That's a great answer. Right in, I like magician as a problem solver. I really do, and I never really thought about it this way, but it was something, because it was something that I always do anyway. Like, just out of habit, because I worked in restaurants, if something spills, I just go over to the bar and be like, hey, throw me a rag real quick, I'm gonna clean this up. And I don't ask anybody, I go like, hey, you do, like, hey, let me get this taken care of, because I can. But I just kind of always do that. But I like that. Like, you were talking about the little girl. I actually carry on me either Tootsie Rolls, Tootsie Pops, like suckers, constantly. I'll have just a little bag that I carry off the back of my hip. that has nothing but candy in it. I always keep a coin on me, and I'll take and just and be like, "Oh, I'm sorry. Here, let me give you candy." And this isn't candy. This is a coin. They'll be like, "I can't eat that," and I'll just do a quick switch, and go, "Oh, but you can take that." And you know, they have a chocolate coin that they could go in. So I always try to keep candy on hand because when you're out and about, whether you're busking or whether you're doing restaurant magic or whatever, like, even if you're performing towards adults, you have to be mindful of the children. And children are, if you have children, if you have nieces, nephews, they are a handful. And getting somebody to swap them from any of the problems that they will have in life is just so nice. It's a reprieve. It's one last fire that, as a parent, they have to put out. And I think it really does. It really does help. I mean, that sort of stuff, especially in the family restaurant environment. Obviously, you know, I'm not going to take. Okay, that's not true. I take suckers to the bars too, because honestly, people love suckers too. Even people at bars love suckers. Magician as a problem solver. That is probably one of the best perspectives I've seen on magician as an entertainer, because honestly, from my perspective, I believe that it's our job to help people. Firemen, and we're not police officers, but we're here to help you in some way, leave you better than when we found you, whether it be just giving you enjoyment or whatever.
I'm not suggesting that they should, you know, take food through to the tables or take dirty plates through and wash them up. But, you know, if I'm at a table and I can do something, yeah, and you're expected to anyway. I mean, I don't think I've ever worked a shift where I've had a table say, "Oh, can we get some more drinks, please?" or "Oh, can we get a napkin, please?" Now, if it's something they're going to have to order, then no problem. I'll just get the waitress to come over and they'll take your order, whatever you want to get. But if they just want an extra fork or a knife or a spoon or a bowl of ketchup, I'll just go and get it myself and take it to them, you know. Because it's a lot easier than stopping somebody else who's doing something else. And as long as I'm not halfway through a table at the time, you know, you have to know your place as well. But yeah, I just get on with it and, you know, I'm part of the team. And that's what it's all about, being part of the team.
Right. Absolutely. All right, so we're 2 minutes from the two-hour mark, but I think...
Boil an egg?
What was that?
Do we boil an egg?
No.
Can I just very quickly say then, the book is The Definitive Guide to Restaurant Magic. You can speak to your magic dealer, whatever magic dealer you go to, and they should be able to get hold of this for you, or you can PM me on Facebook and I will point you towards the website where they're published. And if you're in America, it's lulu.com, and you can, if you're in America, it'll be printed and sent from America to you. If you're in England, it'll be printed and sent from England, so you won't get charged. If you're in America and you're worrying about postage and that, they do it and they print it from America, so from their offices over there. So, but if you PM me, I can send you the link, etc., or you can just speak to your local magic dealer and they will probably be able to get it for you as well. It's £18, I think it works out about $36, $38. And it is rammed full of information. It's my best work today. I'm very proud of it. That's it.
You, by any chance, since we're on doing promos for you, and I am all about just promoing the heck out of you for coming out for us. And I am. Are you doing any? Do you do any lectures? Do you do any lectures over in the UK, or plan on doing any lectures?
Yeah, I lecture all the time. I'm actually in Newcastle next week, which is a big club in the UK. I'm lecturing there next week. But if any clubs in America want me, then yeah, please get in touch. I am more than. I have a number of effects that I've released, like Look Sharp, Lord of the Bling. I've got a new stack system coming out with Dave Forrest and Full 52 Magic. And I have a number of other effects as well. AlakazamMagic.co.uk has some of my effects there. Or you can go to WayneGoodman.co.uk and you'll find some on the product page. That will be filling up very, very shortly with my material. The shop's just gone live on there, so I'm slowly filling that up. Just send us a link and send me a PM, sorry, and I'll send you a link to where everything's at.
Absolutely. Any other products you have coming out anytime soon besides the book?
Well, Tommy's just sent me a PM actually asking me if I'm going to do a wedding reception book, and that is in the works, but I've got other material. I've got a new book on hecklers and how to deal with hecklers that's going to be coming out hopefully for July 17th this year, which is my birthday. And I've also got, which I had here a minute ago, oh, it's down there, a thing I showed you earlier, the Jedi Philosophy, which I'm not going to talk about now, but will be coming out. It's part of the Heckler book, but I'm going to release it as a side thing as well. It's my philosophy on how to be a performer.
Yeah, I'm really interested in that book.
I'll send you a preview of what I've done so far. Yeah. You can have it. Just don't share it.
Okay, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, no, I'm really interested to see how that entire series comes out. So as that progresses, you'll have to keep me updated. All right. So I've been holding off this last question till the end because I thought it would be a nice note to end on. It says best and worst, but I'm going to go with best. What was one of your best restaurant moments? Like, you kind of shared one of your best, one of your most interesting wedding receptions. What's your best restaurant moment? And if you'd like to, what is your worst?
Probably the worst one. Worst, I've got a few. Probably the worst one is when somebody swears at you, tells you to F off, you know, is sort of like, because it's very vocal and it's very, you know, and the guy who did that to me was in a bit of a bad place. He was an arrogant alcoholic and he thought I was coming over to have a go at him and I wasn't. And he just told me, hey, get the out of here. You know, and it was, I don't know why I did that in an American accent. He wasn't American at all. But yeah, it was kind of arrogant.
It's okay. I know.
yeah, I'm not saying Americans are arrogant either, because they're not. But yeah, he was very arrogant and stuff. The best moment, I don't know. I had an incident actually where a little girl followed me around the restaurant and she was about 7 or 8, and she kept coming up to me going, I hate you, you stink, your magic's rubbish, I hate you. I hate you, I hate your magic, you're rubbish at magic, you shouldn't have a job, I wish you'd get sacked, and you stink, and you're old. And it was, I was like, Jesus, you know. And then I was doing another table, and she'd come over and go, I hate you, I hate your magic, why are you even here? And I'm looking at her thinking, oh my God, what is going on? You know, everyone's, and I'm trying to be funny to the grown-ups on performance, going, oh, look, listen, darling, I don't argue with people who have a bedtime. You know, go back to your mum and dad, please. And trying to make a joke out of it. And the mum eventually found me and she said, look, I'm really, really sorry. She's seen you before and she absolutely adores you, but she has a condition and it's about 1,000 times worse than Asperger's. And she can't express herself properly. So everybody gets this really horrible little girl in their face because she's so frustrated because she can't say, I like that. She can't do that. It's physically not possible for her to do that. And she says she's been kicked out of schools and clubs. And I was really felt really sorry for the little girl. And the mum said, you know, if somebody would just spend a little bit of time with her, then they'd see she's actually a darling little girl. So I said, well, let's get her and bring her to the bar. And there's a little alcove in the bar. And I went and sat with her in there and her mum. And it was only the three of us. No one else could see us. It was only the three of us, and I hit her. No, I didn't. We sat there in this little alcove, and I did some tricks just for her. Some, you know, a little bit of coin manipulation and the sponge balls, and then we sang some Frozen songs, and we had a little chat, and I treated her as an equal. I didn't talk down to her like a little girl. I spoke to her how I talk to all children. I don't do this, hello, are you liking the man? I don't do that. I talk to them like a person. I talk to them as an equal. I don't pretend that I'm better than them because I'm older or that I do magic. I talk to them as an equal. Right. And all of a sudden, she just stood up and she put her arms around me and just gave me the biggest hug ever. And I didn't ask her for a hug. I didn't say, can I just have a cuddle? And the mum was in tears and she was like that. She never cuddles men. She hates men. She can't, you know, she that's what she said. Like, you know, she never goes near them. And it was just because I'd made a connection with her. It was just because, you know, I'd spent some time and I'd listened to what she had to say. And I talked to her about Frozen because that's what she was interested in. And I just made that. And I think And I've got hundreds of these stories, because I think as magicians, it's all about making a connection. You know, the people who come back to see me week after week are because I've made a connection with them. The people who book me year after year after year for events and parties and sometimes monthly, and the managers, I've made a connection with them. And I think that's the biggest part of it. And if you can make a connection on a very personal level to the point where you have made an impact on their life, and that can be the smallest little thing can have the... If you throw a big rock into a pond, it's going to make a big ripple. But I can make equally big ripples with a small stone as well. Yeah? And I can make prettier ripples with a small stone. And that's like what I do with the magic. I throw a stone into the mix and I make ripples. And those ripples affect people. And I'm not trying to make myself sound like I'm some amazing, you know, this or that or whatever. But I am very personal because I am so passionate about my magic. I am very personal with people. So I talk to people on a personal level. I engage with them on a personal level. And they book me because even people who have just met me have said that they feel like they've known me for their whole life, because I make that kind of an impression with people. And I think we all have this in us. We all have the ability to do this, to smile when you walk up to a table. When you walk up to the table, have a smile on your face. Say hello. Be polite. Be courteous. Bring them into you. Tell them stories. Sometimes I won't even do any magic at a table. I'll just talk to them and find out where they're from. You know, we get foreign people come to the table. You know, I'll ask them where they're from. I can speak a little tiny bit of lots of languages, so I can speak quite a lot of Danish. I can speak pretty very very good Spanish. Can't speak English. I can speak very good Spanish. I can speak Danish. I can speak German. I can speak French. I can speak Chinese Mandarin. I can speak Japanese. I can speak Filipino Tagalog, and all because when I've travelled around the world working, I've listened and I've picked up these languages, so that when we get a Chinese couple sit down, and I say, oh, you know, and I'll go over and I'll go, ah, oh, hi, shishi, sorry, ni hao, hello. You know, and when I'm finished, I'll say shishi, which is thank you.
Yeah, right.
And it, all those little things that all of a sudden they're like, oh, you've made an effort. You know,
right.
Just the smallest stone, the smallest thing you could do has had a maximum impact on the person. And I think if you take nothing else from this, if you think I've spoke rubbish all the way through, then that's fine. But just be personal, have an impact on people, and that will change everything. And I noticed it. I noticed it when I stopped just being a guy who did card tricks, and I started doing things that the patter I used and the stories I tell are more personal. It has a knock-on effect. It has a ripple effect. And that's when I noticed that my magic had changed. And that's the magician I always wanted to be. That's the person I always wanted to be.
Well, and I think a lot of, and I talk about this sometimes, I think a lot of that has to do with pretense. How you feel about it going in is going to affect the entirety. Doesn't matter how good of an actor you are. Every small nuance of what you do will be affected by your decisions going in. And if you go into a situation like that where you knowingly are going in to make people smile and to help out and to make that connection, if that's your goal, and money has to be a goal too. You have to keep that in mind. But if money isn't your main goal, for example, or at least is not the overshadowing everything else, that shows, you know.
Yeah.
You're not just there for a paycheck, or you're not just there to impress yourself with a neat card trick. You know, you're there to make people smile, which is really, as entertainers, what we're supposed to be doing. We're supposed to be there to entertain others. We're not there for ourselves. We're there for others. I mean, it should be self-gratifying to some extent. We should be there to enjoy ourselves. You're not enjoying yourself, how can you help other people enjoy themselves? But at the same time,
if you look at other professions, if you say like a firefighter, mm-hmm. and you were to see a firefighter, you know, they're there to make a living, to earn money. But when the fire's blazing, they're not thinking about their paycheck at that point. They're thinking about saving people's lives. Now, I know this is a big step away from what we do, but the mindset should be the same. When you go into work, yes, you're there to make a living. Yes, you're there to pay your bills. And your bills aren't going to go away. But your mindset should be... Like when I do cabaret shows, when I'm on stage, I very quickly learn, I've just got a message there from Tommy. Just to let you know, Tommy, I am getting your messages, but I'm not replying while I'm on here, obviously. I very quickly learned, if I go on stage and try and get the audience to enjoy what I'm doing, then it's you know, that can happen, and it's not going to work. Sometimes it'll work, sometimes it won't. Most of the time, it's like a conflict. But if I go on stage with the attitude that I'm going to have a good time, and if you would like to enjoy and have a good time, you're more than welcome to come with me on the journey that I'm going to do, then 90% of the time, 99% of the time, they have a good time too. And so I don't go up there trying to please people and impress people. I go up there to have a good time and enjoy myself, and they come along with me on that journey. And it's the same with the restaurants. You go in to enjoy yourself, have a good time, be courteous, be polite, rapport is all very important, and you build this, then they're going to have a great time, you're going to have a great time, everyone has a great time together, your profile goes up, bookings come rolling in, and the money takes care of itself. You don't need to motivate yourself. If you stress too much about that, oh yeah, but I'm here, I could have been doing a corporate gig for 10 times as much money, then you're never going to have a happy life. You know, take what you have, do what you have, let the gigs take care of themselves, and the money will come in. It's as simple as that, really.
I absolutely agree. It's hard starting out when you don't have money and you feel like every second counts. But you know, it gets easier and it gets better, and it takes time. But you know, in the last 2 hours, you've given such great advice. I've learned a lot. Because though I have done restaurant magic, it's been very limited, and you've answered just a whole list of questions, and I'm really, really interested to see that book. So if you haven't seen or picked up the definitive guide, was it the definitive guide to restaurant magic?
Yep, I will post up a link to the Lulu page. I will post up a link of that on the Believe in Magic page on Facebook. I'll post it up as a thread, and then there's not an American or an English version. When you go to pay for it, it will ask you for your address, and then that will do it automatically for you. People in America, it should automatically go to the American page. It does it. It's a bit like eBay. It automatically detects your location and then just does it from there. But I will post that up in the next like 5-6 minutes once we get finished on here, and then it's there. Please buy as many as you want. Have as many as you want.
Absolutely. You know, pick up the book. It's going to turn out to be, if it has even a quarter of the content that we discussed today, then it's going to be a darn good book. Besides that, I want to thank you, Wayne, for coming out and seeing us and spending this 2 hours and 15 minutes with us doing all this. Thank you very much. I wanted to thank Laura for setting these up. If it wasn't for her, we wouldn't be able to put a lot of these together.
She works very hard. I don't think people realize, you know, because you just see the Facebook page and you just see the comments, but I don't think people realize just how, and you as well, Alex, know the work. I mean, we were talking, I'm not sure what time it is there, but it's 8 o'clock, 8:15 here, and we were discussing this last night at midnight here, you know, and planning stuff, and, you know, people don't realize the work that goes in behind the scenes. So a massive thank you to all the people, you know, behind the scenes who do the time, put the time in to make it for everybody else. It's, you know, these things don't just happen themselves.
We normally don't do this, and we really should. Just a few other people. Sam did our banner. Thank you, Sam. We had a few advertisements go out. The rest of the team, Danny, Scott, Oliver, I know Morgan, Craig, Chris, Kirsten. I always say Kristen, it's Kirsten. I know I'm missing other people, Reed, Connor, all of you guys. You guys do a great job. Thank you for helping put those together. Really thank you to the community. If it wasn't for the community, we wouldn't be able to do things like this and enjoy great guests like Wayne. So thank you all, and I think that's going to be it for today. You like that? Is that good for you, Wayne?
That's good for me. Thank you so much for having me. Thank you for everyone for sending the questions in. If you've messaged me on Facebook or anything, I will eventually get to, over the next couple of hours, I'll answer all the questions that people have put up in there for me as well. And yeah, let's keep the magic real, keep it going, believe in magic.
Absolutely. Believe in magic is a great way to end this. So thank you guys very much. This is going to conclude our broadcast, and we'll see you all later. Bye. If you want to hold on one second, the broadcast is slowing down.